Ever been down to Puerto Rico? High up in the mountains there, they've got this whole array of satellite dishes and sound monitoring devices that scan the skies, listening for something, anything, that creatures from outer space might have to say. So far, nothing. Is it possible that nobody is out there? They're not giving up. 2 years ago, NASA sent a rocket to Mars with a microphone attached to it that they intended to land there. The microphone cost $100,000 to build, was a highly sensitive device, and presumably after landing and deploying, would pick up any sounds that a Martian might like to make, natural or otherwise. Here on Earth, we'd press play and bingo, we'd hear creatures from outer space. What happened, though, is that the rocket entered the Martian atmosphere, got to within a few hundred feet of the surface, started to back down, and then went dead. Nothing has been heard of it since. Now they're going to try again, only this time the attempt will be made by the French. Sometime in the next 2 months, a rocket ship called the Netlander will be fired off from the French Space Center on the island of Tahiti in the Pacific, again bound for Mars. On board will be another microphone of the same design as the one sent off 2 years ago, and once again the rocket will settle down on Mars in the hopes of getting something to speak to us. Frankly, this time, I think we might actually hear something. 2 years ago, it's my belief, the rocket ship dropped down and the microphone swung out on its cord and probably went through the window of some alien's home on that planet. What the? How would you feel if a microphone dangling on a cord suddenly smashed through one of your windows? Your first instinct, I think, would be to rip it out, throw it to the floor, and smash it with your feet. It's the same thing on Mars, except an alien would smash it with his flippers. Well, that was in December of 1999. Can you imagine how sensational it must have been when this smashed-up microphone got brought in to the authorities? They'd look at it and scratch their heads or scratch what passes for their heads, and they'd read where it says Made in China on the back of the plastic case, and they'd say, next time this happens, let's tell them a thing or two. The word would then go out that Puerto Rican satellite dish was built so long ago with such early technology it probably never was able to pick anything up. That if a microphone drops down from a cord in the sky, don't be afraid of it. Talk into it. Say something. Start spreading the news. Da-da-da-da.
I'm leaving today.
By the way, I have just read an interview with a man in Arizona who, years ago, had an atomic bomb accidentally dropped into his backyard from an Air Force bomber on a training mission passing overhead. It didn't go off, obviously, but the fuse detonated and the little explosion it made dug a 50-foot diameter crater in the yard. Walter Gregg, who told authorities about it at the time, was considered crazy by many, but recently released secret Air Force documents revealing that it absolutely happened in 1958 and the government kept it all hush-hush. I was in the house at the time, Gregg said, and I ran out and there was just this curl of smoke rising from this big hole. I was contacted by the Air Force, who offered me $500 to fill in the hole, but I figured the only way I could fill in the hole would be to dig another hole nearby, and I would just as soon have the hole in the part of the yard where it was, so I refused. It's still there. This was not the only accident over mainland America involving accidentally dropped atomic bombs. According to the document just released, during a 20-year period, there were 61 accidental atomic bomb dropping occurrences, most involving B-52s. Until now, nobody knew.